De Nexus-conferentie van dit jaar staat in het teken van The Battle Between Good and Evil. Sprekers komen van over de hele wereld en vanuit verschillende vakgebieden. De openingslezing wordt verzorgd door Marilyn Robinson, bekroond auteur, favoriet van Barack Obama en een van de belangrijkste religieuze denkers van nu. Ze sprak eerder bij Nexus en maakte toen indruk met haar kritiek op het reductionisme in de wetenschap en haar vurige pleidooi voor een religieus humanisme.
I so often find that science creates a sort of cyst around a particular discipline and assumes that the terms that are appropriate for that discipline can be generalized to the largest scale. I mean, I have heard scientists say the self is a piece of meat. Now, this is a, you know, this means the self is the brain. It's the same thing. But then, you know, if you study what meat is, it is infinitely complex. If you read about the healing of a wound, it is infinitely complex. There isn't, you know, a huge value has to be placed on a human being, which is also a piece of meat, you know? If you say that dismissively, you are making a value statement that devalues human beings. If you say it in perfect scientific awe of what it actually does mean, then you are valuing lives.
De mens is niet zomaar een stuk vlees, maar het vlees dat we zijn kunnen we wel aanpassen met nieuwe technologie. En als we dat doen, wat gebeurt er dan met onszelf? Anders Sandberg denkt daarover na. Hij is futuroloog en noemt zichzelf transhumanist.
So classical humanism said that humans matter. Humans can improve their own conditions by rationality, education, better societies. Transhumanists say, yeah, that's true, but we can also improve ourselves by genetic engineering, by having computer implants, by modifying ourselves. So this might involve you might want to upgrade your genes, slow down your aging, or change the color of your skin. And I think we actually need to think about what we want to become, what aspect of ourselves we might want to overcome, what aspects we would cherish and want to culture, and what might emerge from that.
Catherine Nixie richt haar kritiek niet op het humanisme, maar op het christelijk geloof. Haar moeder was een non, haar vader een monnik. Zelf deed ze onderzoek naar het vroege christendom en de boodschap van het evangelie.
What a good news. This birth of Christ and Christianity.
Well, I think like anything, it depends who you ask.
I ask you.
If you ask a Christian, they would have said yes. I mean, if you asked one of the what we would call pagans, but they would never have called themselves pagans, who were cowering as they watched, you know, monks enter their home with an axe, as happened in Alexandria, or as they watched the greatest temple in the world being torn down by a bishop and his zealous followers in Alexandria in Egypt, then they wouldn't have said this is good. But I mean, the whole idea of good and evil, that there are these two separate, distinct ideas that you can place, not just separate to each other with that and in the middle, but that geographically they're miles apart. One is in heaven, one is in hell. They're a million miles from each other to us. I mean, that is a very novel idea. And the idea that you have a God who is policing them, I mean, that to the Roman eyes didn't seem like a good idea at all. They were aghast. Who is this peculiar God, they used to write? You know, who is this strange man who is following me, you tell me, in everything I do? And my book opens with an attack on a temple in Palmyra by what is assumed to have been Christians who, in that period, were terrorizing the east of the Roman Empire. They were attacking temples of the old gods. And I found that, sure enough, the story I'd been brought up with just wasn't the case, or wasn't wholly the case.
Uit datzelfde deel van de wereld komt Tarek Mitri, Libanees politicus en diplomaat. Hij bekleedde diverse ministersposten en was VN-vertegenwoordiger in Libië. Al jarenlang zet hij zich in voor de dialoog tussen verschillende religies.
You mentioned that I worked in the area of dialogue among people of different faith. And part of the dialogue exercise, part of it, not all of it, is like negotiations. And sometimes it's like what we call in the secular world track two diplomacy, where, you know, a country like Bosnia or Nigeria or Ireland, where there are conflicts that have a religious dimension, And we people involved in dialogue used to try to pool our resources, join our efforts to bring peace to those situations. But in meeting this challenge, you learn a lot about the power of words, the value of compromise, of trade-offs, and this is what diplomacy is about. And there are, I think, people who misunderstand pluralism and the necessity to respect the plurality of opinions, traditions, religions, histories. They misunderstand that with total relativism. I think there is a core of human values that bind us together, and unless we adhere to those values, peaceful, harmonious living together is not possible.
Ook de Oostenrijkse nieuwrechtse filosoof Caroline Sommerfeld heeft het over waarden, maar dan heel anders. Volgens haar staan de traditionele westerse waarden onder druk door immigratie. Links beleid van open grenzen zou Europa tot chaos brengen.
Maybe I can explain something about explaining the cover of that book. That was the two of us leaning to a wall close to my home, and on the wall there was written the slogan of no borders. That's everywhere in Vienna. There's graffiti with that. And we tried to put our bodies in front of this graffiti, and then it says no order. If you destroy the border between inside and outside, then the system collapses. Then you get chaos. And I think in the political field, it's kind of the same. So if you don't put up strong borders, that really means real borders.
Maar wat gebeurt er dan met al die mensen die bescherming zoeken tegen oorlogsgeweld? Zoals Kassem Eid. In 2013 overleefde hij de gifgasaanval van Assad en ontvluchtte hij Syrië. Hij begrijpt de zorgen over vluchtelingen, maar benadrukt de kracht van diversiteit.
Well, I respectfully understand all the concerns about having huge numbers of refugees coming to Europe, to Germany, to anywhere. In Syria, we had a lot of refugees coming from Lebanon, for example, in 2006, and then 2003, a lot of people came from Iraq, and we saw how things might actually change. Diversity is strength, it's not weakness. The United States is the most powerful country on this planet because of its diversity. The reason that country growed and kept growing because of the diversity it has. There is racism wherever you go in this world, but in the same time, you can never forget how much efforts people here in Europe, especially in Germany, made to actually take care of millions of refugees. This is something we will never forget and we will be forever grateful.